What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Couple of months back, we launched and continuously enriched our unit tests and TDD series. Part of the series was an introductory video on mocking and how we can use mocks to improve and target specific units of our application while testing it. Today we are going to start with another series of videos in which we focus on the Mockito library. You see, Mockito is an open source test automation framework that internally uses Java's Reflections API to create mock objects. And as a reminder, mock objects are dummy objects used instead of the actual implementation. The main purpose of using these objects is allow our tests to focus on a single unit by mocking the external dependencies of this unit and using them in the code. Additionally, and as we previously mentioned, mocking should be done in unit tests when the real object has a non-deterministic behavior, or the real object is a callback function, or the real object is yet to be implemented. So, to get started, you'll want to add Mockito's corresponding Maven or Gradle dependencies alongside your JUnit 5 dependency. Here we'll be using Maven. The first thing we'll do is create a new test method, and in it we'll initialize our first mock. Let's keep it simple and start with a list. Now, to manipulate the behavior of this list, we can make use of the when method. Here we are telling it to return the string like whenever we request the first element of that mocked list. If you are working along the video, you may have noticed the thenAnswer and thenThrow options you get on top of the thenReturn one while typing it. Do not worry about these for now, we will make sure to tackle them further in this video. The last step of any unit test is assertion. Let's assert that our mock works correctly. As you can see, our test is green and Mockito did perfectly its job. If it wasn't for that mock, we would certainly have got an out-of-bounds exception. Okay, before proceeding to more Mockito methods and before writing more unit tests, I want to show you another way to actually create this mock, and it's by making use of the @mock annotation. However, if we try to run the test as is, it will fail with a null pointer exception on the mock itself. You see, this mock was never initialized. To initialize it, we used to make use of the initMocks method, but this was deprecated, as you can tell from the strike through on it. So how are we going to initialize our mocks? To do that, we can make use of a combination of JUnit 5's extendWith annotation and pass to it the Mockito extension class. The line we just added will ensure that our mocks are initialized at the beginning of our tests every time we run them. Let's go ahead and rerun our test. As you can see, it passes successfully. Another annotation you'll find yourself using is the @spy annotation. Again, from now on I'll be using annotations, but remember that everything can be done without them. For example, you can also create a spy by making use of the spy method. Okay, before proceeding, you need to know that a spy is used to create a real object and spy on it. You see, sometimes you do not want to mock the behaviors of a particular object, you want to let it behave normally, but spy on it. Or in some rare cases, you want to mock particular behaviors, but let others behave normally. A spy in Mockito is a partial mock. When you are not stopping a method, then the real behavior will be called. So, back to our example, here we are spying on a list. Then, after adding an element to this list, we are making sure that the add functionality was called, and that this list was indeed populated with one element. If you go ahead and replace the @spy annotation with the @mock annotation, you will see that the test goes from green to red, and that the size of the list is no longer 1, but is now 0, because in case of a mock, it isn't actually populated. This behavior is mocked. However, in case of a spy, the element was actually added. Using this same example, we can introduce another Mockito annotation, the @captor annotation. This annotation is used to capture method argument values for further assertions. In this unit test, we added a new element in our spy, and upon verifying our call, we captured this element and then asserted the retrieved value separately using the assert equals method. The captor is mainly used when the passed argument is a complex object and deep assertions need to be done on it. Here it was simply a string, just for the sake of the example. Okay, before tackling the next annotation, we're going to take things up a notch and create a simple service class. Let's say this class relies on a repository which communicates with our database and on some other service. Now, by making use of these injected dependencies, our main service will be able to offer us new functionalities which we want to test, and to do that efficiently without being affected by errors that may occur on the repository or the other service side, we are going to mock these two classes. To do that, we are going to start by creating a test class for our service, add the Mockito extension, and mock the repository and the other service we need. Okay, to test our main service, we need to first use its actual behaviors, so we mustn't mock it. And secondly, we need to inject the mocks we just created into the instance of the service we create so that our unit test tests this service and this service only without being influenced by outer modifications. This is done by simply making use of the @injectMocks annotation. As you can see in the example test we put together, our service calls the mocks correctly with no exceptions, clearly demonstrating that our mocks were accurately injected. Now, speaking of exceptions, that's exactly what we are going to tackle next. Mockito allows you to manipulate behaviors in a way that makes them throw exceptions, allowing you to test their not-so-happy paths. In this example, we made use of the thenThrow method to assert that a custom exception we created will be thrown by our main service if an issue is encountered at the level of the other server we depend on. Okay, I couldn't possibly cover everything Mockito allows us to do in a single video, so the last thing I want to tackle today is the thenAnswer method. While making use of the when functionality to stub our methods, we came across three options: thenReturn, thenAnswer, and thenThrow. Now, we just explained thenThrow and it's kind of pretty obvious and restricted to what we saw. But what about the other two? When to use each of them? The simple answer to this is use thenReturn when you know and want a specific return value at the time you mock a method call, and use thenAnswer when you need to do additional actions when a mocked method is invoked. Example, when you need to compute the return value based on the parameters of this method call. In the example you see, and similarly to all the examples we had at the beginning of the video, we know exactly what we want to return. So we made use of the thenReturn method with our mock. We are testing this specific functionality. On the other hand, in this second example, we are making use of the arguments passed to the method we are stubbing to deduce the value we want to return. You see, in the thenAnswer method, the return value is computed at runtime while the test is running. In the first example, we did not make use of the like argument, so no matter what the argument is, 10 will be returned. However, in the second example, our return value depends on the passed argument. Let me know in the comments below if you'd like a part 2 Mockito video where we dive deeper in its functionalities. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.